this morning. I hope everybody's been doing okay this past week. Certainly been somewhat of a troublesome week with some right there, but we're glad that we have the opportunity to be with the Lord this morning, be here in his house, be with one another right there. He said it was by this that he would know that we were his disciples, by the love we have one for another. And so I'm glad that that's what is most prevalent here at Good News Baptist Church, is the love of the Lord. If you're joining us online, we certainly appreciate you being here with us this morning. And for those that are missing from our midst, we certainly miss you, and we're looking forward to the time when you're able to be back with us. If you will, let's all stand, turn over to page number 202 in your songbooks right here. We're going to sing the old gospel ship.
People tell the Lord, and strive is weary, so weary.
Yes, ma'am.
Fella, that's gonna be a mansion.
Yes.
I've seen a lot of rich folks in my life, seriously, I have. I seen, all Mr. Movie Star dudes of the, Highlands. Now, he got a big, he had a big place, he gone now, but, what I'm saying, he's passed away. But, I'll tell you this, this is something. I hauled one place up there, they had almost $1 million in it, didn't even have woodwork. Now, that's what I'm talking about.
Yeah. Thank you, Lord. Do you have that on the screen there, Brother Nathan?
I Lord, you're the best thing. I don't know if you do or don't.
Size and who you are. He said, I'd say back in your day, you were an issue sometimes to deal with. And I said, probably so. But I said, I want you to know, I'm a Christian. And he said, yeah. And he said, John, it shows. He said, you'd be surprised at the people that look at you and see what you are now. And folks, that kind of squared me a little bit.
Yeah.
What I'm saying, I enjoyed that. Mm-hmm. Because now, he wasn't bragging on me. He bragging on the Lord.
Amen.
And he told me, he said, John, he said, oh, you can see that. Mm-hmm. He said, you don't get flushed, right? Nothing. And he said, Richard, he said, it's been superb working for you. I'm not going to call this lawyer name. But if I had to have somebody,
it'd be one to use, wouldn't it?
Yes, he was.
Amen. Christ alone, guys.
But in Christ alone is where it matters.
Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Got one more one day. Lord, I need you.
Oh, Got to remember the sign up sheet up front for the sweetheart dinner, and that's February 6th at 6 o'clock. And y'all, Benita needs a head count, so she needs it. If you're planning on attending, she needs you to sign up. And remember tonight's Bible study starting at 6 o'clock. And this week, if nothing happens, we're going to start back the Pioneer Club at 6 o'clock this Wednesday. Any more announcements? That's on Friday. Any birthdays this week?
I heard Sandra Tanksley's got one.
Sandra Tanksley's got one. I hear that she's another year old.
Anyone else? Okay, happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Any anniversaries? And we all stand, we get a couple of ushers. Any unspoken prayer requests, raise the hand. Pray, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for this day and all you've done for us, Father. Lord, just thank you for each family that's gathered here today and represented, Father, Lord, and for each of those families watching at home, Father. Father, we go through the remainder of your service, Father. Just take this offering, Father, just bless it for you, Father. Bless those that can and cannot give, Father, that we'll just use this offering to further it for your kingdom, Father. Brother Austin comes, Father, just hide him behind the cross, Father. Just let us see you and not him, Father, Lord. Just give him the worth to save, Father. We come back tonight for the Bible study, Father, Lord. We know it's been a while, Father, just to give each teacher the words to say, Father, and give everyone here in this building today, Father, whether it be now or tonight, Father, Just give them receptive hearts to hear you with. In Jesus' name, amen. This will be the last Sunday the sign-up sheet will be up here. So this will be it for that.
Ladies to bring dessert.
Okay. Ladies to bring dessert.
Thank you, everyone. Appreciate it. Mm-hmm. Come on, Brother Austin. You've been having a good week so far. I'd like for you to turn with me to Psalms 84, if you'll be turning there. Psalms 84. While you're turning, just let me say thank you for your prayers real quickly on behalf of Miss Diane and her family. Kevin's still in the hospital, but hopefully home soon. He has vastly improved, and so we certainly appreciate you praying for him. I'd like to ask you to keep praying for him. I know you will, and I know you are. But just as a reminder, Miss Teresa Jaworski and others of our church family that has been dealing with some long-term things. And so we do want to thank you for praying for them. Also, Miss B. Humphreys, please remember Miss B. Today. She's almost a neighbor of Cindy and I. And so it's Miss Sandra's sister. So please pray for Miss B. I met a young man this week, lost his car. And I don't know his name, but I'd ask you to pray that he won't have too much of a problem getting his car replaced. He told me that it was his only car. So I'd love for him and his young family to have a way of going back soon. And so you please pray for him. And today also I was asked to mention the family of Miss Marvine Tatum. Many of you may know Mr. James Tatum that ran the airport for many, many years. Mr. James passed away a couple of months ago. Now his wife, Marvine, has passed away. And so my mom asked me to ask you to pray for their family today. And we're thankful, as I said, to be able to be here with you this morning, looking forward to our Bible study tonight. And certainly been praying about all of our teachers, praying for all of our teachers, that the Lord would just richly bless them. I've been praying for all of you all throughout the week that as you study that you could retain that and that you would enjoy that, and I'm sure you have, and looking forward to you being able to share that. I just, what a blessing it is to have our folks involved in ministry. Several of our folks had texted me or let me know this morning that they could not be here today, but a number of them are going to be trying to make it back from where they are and what they're doing, where they can be here tonight. So I certainly hope so. This morning I want to talk to you for a few minutes about what you'd rather do, what you'd rather be doing. If you work at something that you like to do, then you're blessed, aren't you? Most of us, we at work, we'd rather be doing something else. We'd rather be fishing, or we'd rather be, you know, doing something we enjoy. I've talked to a number of students that tells me that they had rather be at school. And now, before this pandemic, they might not have said that when it was no problem to get to school. But trying to do their work from a computer screen and that kind of thing, not seeing their friends, not being where they can interact with their teachers, that kind of thing, they tell me, even though school's not maybe one of their favorite things, but they'd rather be at school. And so what we'd rather do says a whole lot about who we are and how we are, doesn't it? And what we'd rather be doing. David, in this particular passage in verse 10 there,
You'll notice he said he'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God, he said, than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. We'll go over these verses here in a few minutes. Jerry Reed used to have a song many years ago, and it talked about a preacher that had rather went hunting that Sunday than he had to go to church. You may remember that song, The Preacher and the Bear. He said in his chorus of that song, he said, "You delivered Daniel from the lion's den, Jonah from the belly of the whale within, the Hebrew children from the fiery furnace, so the good book do declare, hey, Lord, if you can't help me, for heaven's sakes, don't help that bear." That's kind of the attitude we get, ain't it? Even if we kind of blow off church, if we don't want to do too many things of God or too many things that reflect faith, we don't want to have any problems, do it. We definitely want God still working on our side, whether we act like we're on His or not. I'm glad it's not something that we're working out with God. I'm glad we're not bartering these things with God. Anybody else glad of that? I'm glad it's His grace, aren't you? Amen. I'm thankful it's all His favor. I'm thankful, listen, if we did mess up that day, we're still saved. If we did mess up that day, He still loves us. If we did mess up that day, He still cares for us, still has compassion. He's still with us. He's not left us. And so the main thing is that we just don't do that on purpose. And so even if we did do it on purpose, He still loves us. But what I'm saying is, what do we rather be doing? This is a psalm that talks about the house of God. That's what it's talking about. And in the day this was written, the house of God was a tabernacle. It was the tent of meeting that David had moved to the city of Zion, or the city of David. It housed the Ark of the Covenant like it always did. It was attended by the Levites. The priests were there. It was a place of sacrifice. The temple had not been built yet. You remember David had a real heart to build a temple, especially in his later years. He had a real zeal that he wanted to build a building to house the Ark of the Covenant. He wanted to build a building that would reflect the best the nation could do to honor God. He understood that God was the great invisible El Shaddai, in Hebrew, God Almighty, that there's no building that could house the presence of God. God was not like the idols where the nations around them and the cultures that were around them would build temples, great temples to their idols, and they would make that idol the focal point of coming into that building. Well, he understood that their relationship with God was not at all like that. It wasn't anything of the sort. He knew that God could not be, as I said, he could not be contained in some earthly type building or condition. He knew that God had made it all. I mean, when David had it in his heart to build a building for the Ark of the Covenant, that was what it would house. That represented God's presence. And so when he had that desire to do that, Nathan the prophet told him, he said, "What kind of building would you build me? I mean, how could it be? What would you do? I mean, what? In other words, what he's saying is, what would make it enough? What would make it enough? I mean, if we were trying to reflect our attitude and thoughts and appreciation to God by this building, then we have failed sorely, haven't we? I mean, nothing's wrong with a building. Thankful for the building. Victory, the church right next to us up there has just got finished remodeling their sanctuary. And as I came by their parking lot this morning, I noticed it was almost completely full, their parking lot. And so I was very happy for them. I was very thankful. I'd stopped a time or two and went in there. And I noticed all this week, every day, even yesterday, people were there all day long working on it, trying to get it finished, trying to get it ready. Why? Because one thing, it needed it from a long time ago. And two, it helps them further reflect their appreciation of having a place to worship. You and I appreciate this place. Yes, we do. But when it comes to trying to honor God with what we can provide, what we can show, and what we do, it doesn't matter what we do, we're still going to fall short. The temple that Solomon built, get this in your mind, the temple that Solomon built, the walls were lined with beaten gold. The doors were lined with beaten gold. When you walked in that place, you saw a golden room in there. I mean, you can't improve on that, can you? The richest people on earth could not buy that. They could not provide that. But yet that's what the nation of Israel did. David gathered all that stuff together, and he got all that. But he had a real heart to build a place that would represent God's presence in the kingdom and in the nation and in the capital city. And so he had a real heart for that. So some scholars say that it's not clear if David wrote this psalm or not. They say that it may have been written later. We know that according to Scofield's titles here, it's been written as a song or a psalm for the sons of Korah. The sons of Korah were Levite singers. That's who they were. They would sing these hymns and these chants and these psalms at different times and different days of worship, different situations of worship is what they would do. But some scholars say he wrote it while he was fleeing from Saul, but more than likely David wrote this when he was fleeing Jerusalem temporarily from Absalom, his son, because in David's latter days, that's when he had a real zeal and a real heart for that place of God and that house of God. And that's what this psalm is reflecting. The writer of this psalm cannot write now at this moment that he's writing that. He cannot attend the house of God or the tabernacle of worship. He can't go right now. And so his heart is longing to do that. In other words, he'd rather be there. He'd rather be at that place of worship. He'd rather be attending that house of God. The world around us today, beloved, is looking at our attitude, by the way, toward the house of God. And it's not just coming and sitting in these pews. It's actually, listen, what takes place in this place, the teaching from this word right here, and how much influence it has and how much bearing it has on our interaction with the world out there. As we talked about Wednesday night, tried to share with you Wednesday night, we talked about the benefits of the golden rule, or that legacy, or the attributes of it, what it did, its effectiveness in our lives, and our effectiveness then in the lives of other people, and reflecting what the Lord said to do and how he said to do it. I want you to know it does work. It works from the schoolhouse to the cemetery, amen? It does work. It works at home. It works at church. It works at work. It works at the store. It works. Great attributes of living the golden rule and treating people like you, I feel, would be the best way for a person to be treated. Listen, that does work. And so the things that takes place at the house of God, this writer of these 12 little verses here, they understood that that was of high value. They appreciated that. I invited a fellow to revival one time, and I did it discreetly. Matter of fact, we were in a metal shop, and a lot of noise was going on. A lot of things were happening. A number of men were in there trying to prepare material for a project that was taking place, a big commercial project. We were making, those of us that knew how, were making metal, that kind of thing. And this I had invited. We were having revival. The church that I was attending wasn't pastoring, wasn't even preaching then. But it was. I was inviting the folks, the fellas, to revival. I didn't gather them up in a group and invite them, but I just kind of individually invited them. And so this one fella, I got close to him and just invited him. And so he waited until he got as far as from here to Nathan nearly, and then he hollered back across all of that, trying to get above all of that. He was doing that to try to build himself up and try to put me down. I understood what he was doing, but he let me know from that distance that he would not come. He could have just told me that while I was this close to it. But he didn't do it. He wanted to wait. And he let me know that he would not come. And so I walked back over there to where he was. I mean, you got to take some stuff away from the devil, amen? I could have just conversed with him from that distance, but no. I walked back over there where he was, and I said, look, if you don't want to come, you don't have to come. Just inviting you. That's simply it. He said, well, I just want to let you know. He said, church for me when I was a kid meant a beating when I got home. And he said, I will not come. I will not subject my boys to that, this kind of thing. So I asked him the type church that he went to. And he told me that it was a strict, really, he didn't use these terms, but it was a real strict legalistic type place. That's what he told me. I said, listen, I want you to know all places are not like that. Don't just judge one book by, the old books by one cover. I mean, don't do that, because they're not all like that. He said, well, either way, I'm not coming. I said, well, I just wanted to invite you. We'll leave it laying right there. Well, my point is simply this. For him to see any value in the house of God, he didn't see none. The way he related to the house of God, it meant getting a whooping. It meant that, you know, him as a little kid couldn't sit still and quiet for 3 hours. That's what it meant. It meant that, you know, every time he related things to the house of God, it was negative, it was bad, it was not good, it was not worth anything to him. As a matter of fact, it was so, it left such an impression on him, he didn't want his family to have anything to do with it. Unfortunately, this same fella divorced his wife. He lost those boys that he was talking about. He wasn't going to subject to that. I'm not putting him down, but what I'm saying is the house of God, if he'd went to the right one and stayed for the right reasons, it might have helped that. Yeah, amen. Might have helped that. Everything don't just go perfect, and you and I know that, just because we attend the house of God. But how many would say it's a blessing to be in the house of God? I mean, hey, you're here this reason. You're here this morning for a reason. I'm thankful that you're here. I believe there's others watching that will be back. I believe there's others that would be here if whatever was going on with them had not been. I believe that today, and I believe there's some that just not here because the band felt too good. They're just not here because they just rather be somewhere else, rather be doing something else. I'm just being honest today. That's all. One of the things that I appreciate about you, and I'm going to read the scriptures to you here. One of the things that I was thankful for is when we were having no services at all, I would get calls. You would contact me, or the deacons would talk about it. It stayed active in their conversations about when we could start having some sort of services. Why? Because most of you wanted to. Most of you wanted to come back. You wanted to have a service outside, whatever. You wanted to come here. You wanted to come and worship here. Thank you for that. Thank you. The church has hope. The church will, listen, the church will stand with you with that attitude. Amen. And so thank you. And so let me just put that right out there. Give you a few flowers. Let you sniff them a minute. Amen. Because, hey, it's a blessing that you wanted to do that. But you'll notice the writer here, as he is not able to attend the house of God. I got 3 points I want to share with you. Number one, this writer, he was delighted. He was delighted in the house of God. There's a verse, it's a life verse for me, and it's Psalms 37:4. Delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thine heart. You guys, you'll notice a little word there also. I didn't give that verse to Nathan, but you'll notice a little word in that particular passage that said also. It don't mean that you're not delighted in other things, but you delight yourself also in the Lord. You see that up there also? I mean, when he's part of what you enjoy, when he's part of what you value, when he's part of what you identify with, when he's part of something, you know, he's a part of your life that brings you, dare I say it, some pleasure. I mean, he's part of that. He's a good part of that. And the Bible said, when we delight ourselves also in him, and he shall give thee the desires of thine heart. Why would he do that? Because, listen, your heart is lining up with his. That's why. The writer here, if this be David, and I believe it is, his heart lined up with the Lord. He had a delight. Notice in verse number 1, he said, how amiable. Or in other words, what he's saying is, he's saying how lovely, how good-natured, how friendly are thy tabernacles, O Lord of hosts. In other words, how wonderful it'd be if I could just be there again. How great it would be. Listen, if I could just go there, just be a part of what's taking place there again. I dare say there's probably some folks watching us out there, and age and health is going to keep you from going much of anywhere again. And you'd love to be in the house of God again. If they could be here and stand and say it to our young people today that maybe had rather be somewhere else, and I'm not trying to say you're bad folks, it's nothing like that. I'm just saying when I was a teenager, and hopefully you're not like this, when I was a teenager, listen, I almost lived in church. Mom sung all the time. And listen, and we're almost all the time in church. The family was involved in ministry. I got so tired of going to church. I'm telling you, if you'd have asked me, sitting back there somewhere, would you rather be somewhere else? I'd have said, yes. But I sure wouldn't have said it in front of them. I'd rather have been somewhere else. Had plenty of this. Had a lot of this. Had too much of this. This writer is saying, I love it. How lovely it is, how wonderful it is, how awesome it is to go to the house of God, to be there at what's taking place and what's going on, to be a part of that. Oh, Lord of hosts, notice the last part. Oh, Lord of hosts, in other words, he had the right focus. He wasn't going there to see what would make him happy. He wasn't going there to see what he liked or he didn't like. He wasn't going there to form some criticism about this or that or how this or why that. It wasn't anything like that. The Lord was his focus. I'm going because the Lord is being honored and worshiped there. They're lifting up praise to the Lord there. They're talking about the Lord there. I want to go be part of that. He said, it's lovely, amiable. My soul longeth, yea, even fainteth for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh crieth out for the living God. You see that heart of worship that he really had. He didn't go there to see whoever he could see. He didn't go there that people might admire him as the king. You got to keep in mind, he's a pretty important person, amen? He didn't go there. You know what? If one of our presidents were to come this morning and the public knew they were coming, they would have packed this place out. Why? Just to be able to see somebody famous, somebody important, somebody that was notable. Maybe got a selfie with them, something like that. I mean, they would have wanted people to know, hey, I went and I stayed and I saw and I said hello, all this kind of thing. The king himself is saying here, it's not about that. I just want to go because I love the Lord and want to be in his presence. He's the most important one there. Ooh, how awesome it'd be in church if he, the Lord Jesus, the Holy Spirit, was the most important one there. Amen. You're important. You're so important he came and died for you. He gave us this word. He sent this. He put a calling in our heart. Why? For people, for you. But I'm here to tell you, listen, when we make him the most important one there, we can get delighted in church. He was delighted about it. Yes, he did. He said, my flesh, look at that. My flesh crieth out. Did you notice that? Don't miss it. My flesh crieth out. What's that mean? He's got this stuff under control. This stuff's being controlled. These feelings and little temporary, you know, things that are not controlling him. These urges and desires and things he just feels like he has to do is not controlling him. No, it's under control. He said, I brought this vessel into compliance with the scriptures, and it's praising him. Amen. Amen. That's what he's saying. Yea, the sparrow hath found an house, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young. Even thine altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. In other words, he's saying the little birds that can fly over your altar. He's saying the sparrows, the birds that can make a nest close by the worship. All these little birds that are not restricted, they're better off than I am right now. At least they can be there. He said, I'd love to be like one of them. I'd love for my condition, my situation to be like one of them. I'd love to be able to go. There might be some older folks watching today or some folks watching today that love to be here. They'd just give anything if they could be here or a place like this. They might say to our young folks, hey, don't give it up today because, hey, you'll long for it later. I'd love to be here. He said, all them little birds are in better shape than me. My goodness, they can go where I can't go. They can see what I can't see. They can be a part of what I can't do right now. No, they're better off than me. Boy, he's got a longing for it, don't he? He's desiring it, amen? I mean, he'd rather be there. He is delighted in the things of God. He's delighted in those things. Blessed are they that dwell in the house. They will be still praising thee, Shelah. In other words, look at that verse a minute. It's what the psalmist is saying. He's saying those people are blessed. Amen. If there's one thing that the community should say about everybody that takes up a seat in this place, they're blessed. Amen. They're blessed. They see it. They hear it. They observe it. They're blessed. Oh, the psalmist is saying, hey, I'm blessed when I'm at the house of God. I'm blessed when I'm there, a part of what the people of God are doing. I'm blessed when I'm hearing the scriptures. I'm blessed when I'm in the fellowship of the family. I'm blessed when I'm hearing and a part of the songs of Zion. I'm blessed in those things. I'm blessed in the altars. I'm blessed with the people of God. I am blessed in these conditions. I am blessed in these things. I may not be blessed at Walmart. I may not be blessed at my job. I may not be always blessed at school. I may not be always blessed at home. David can say, I may not be always blessed in the palace. I may not be always blessed running the military. I may not be always blessed talking to my cabinet that helps me run the government. I may not be always blessed in these things, but I'm blessed at the house of God. I'm blessed there. Oh, how awesome it'd be if we could delight ourselves in the Lord completely and absolutely and just come in here, listen, and just lay, if you will, just lay the issues and conditions of life down and focus on Him and say, oh, we're blessed, Lord, just to be here, just to be in the presence of people who love You, be in the presence of people who want to honor You, who are looking for You, who are delighted, takes pleasure in being around the things that pertain to You. And then the second point I want to make, he was determined. He was determined. Verse number 5. Blessed is the man whose strength is in Thee, whose heart are the ways of them. Look at this. Look at what he is saying here. He's saying, blessed is the man whose strength is in Thee. I'm gaining strength. In other words, he's determined that even though he can't be in the house of God right now, even though he can't be on that holy site right now, he can't be there partaking and being a part of what's taking place right now. He's saying, it's not, even though I've had to leave in, it has not left me. He said, that's where my strength has come from. My strength is in Him. My strength, my dependence, my expectation, it's upon Him. Things may be not going all that good right now, but he's saying, I want you to know I'm blessed because my strength is in Thee, whose heart, whose mind, if you will, are the ways of them. In other words, I'm going to follow what I learned there. Amen. I'm going to follow what I heard there. I'm going to apply. Listen. What was said to me there. Why? Because, hey, his life was in trouble right at the moment. But he understood, listen, his heart was there at the house of God. He understood, listen, that what had took place with him over there didn't just happen there. Isn't that a good thing about this word? How many of you's got a Bible? You got a Bible? You may not have it with you. Most of you's got it with you. Some of you may be looking on your phones, your electronic devices. That's okay too. But what I'm simply saying is, thank God for access to the Word of God. I'm glad that you just don't get it here. I'm glad that you got access out there. But I'm glad it can be, listen, expounded upon here. This is what he's saying. He's saying, look, he's determined. This is not going to leave me. I'm drawing strength from it. When you're getting strong from something, when something, listen, is working out for you, you and I'll develop a determination, won't we? To keep it up. To keep doing it. To keep embracing it. The greatest athletes are those who are what? Determined and disciplined. Certainly, they want to keep embracing the rule of the game. They want to keep on honing their skills. They want to keep getting better. They haven't got to the place where they want to level out. No, they want to keep getting better. They're playing, coaches would say it this way, they're playing with heart. Yes. Their heart's in it. Yes. They're determined. Their desire's there. Listen, this writer is saying, my heart's in it. I'm not doing as good as the birds that can just fly over to their nest close by, but my heart's in it. It's worth something to me. He's determined. Look at it. Who passing through the valley of Baca, that means the valley of weeping. I'm weeping over it. I'm heartbroken because of it. I can't change it right now. How many's got something you're heartbroken over because you can't change right now? It's not different. It's not happened yet. You see in your mind, you have a vision of things being so different. You can see it coming together. You can see, you understand what the Holy Spirit can do. But because maybe of resistance, stubbornness, whatever, because just unwillingness, not necessarily on your part. Maybe you can see this in your family's lives. You can see this in another condition. But you just can't get in there and change it all. Listen, things has got to happen, friend. But hey, you know that it can be different. You're weeping over it. Notice what he said. He said, who passing through the valley of Baca. Now, who's passing through the valley of weeping? It's those who are getting strength. It's those who have a heart that has set their way, set their heart on the ways of God. He said they're passing through that valley of weeping. Wouldn't it be great if you and I as believers, if the scripture just guaranteed us no more troubles, no more heartbreaks, no more problems, no more accidents, no more struggles? Wouldn't that be good? No more insults. Oh, listen, no more lack. No more discouragement. Wouldn't that be good if the scripture would just guarantee that kind of thing? Wouldn't that be good? But what does the Bible say? The Bible says in Romans 8 and 28 that he makes all things, listen, work together for good to those who are the called according to his purpose. Look, he's saying we're going through, who passing through the valley of Baca weeping, make it a wail, and a rain also filleth the pools. What's he saying? He's turning our trials into a blessing. That's what he's saying. He said, I can't be at the house of God right now. I can't go. I'd rather be there, but I can't be there. It's not possible right now. I can't walk up on that holy site. I can't be a part of what they're doing. It's broken my heart. I'm in a valley. Notice valley's always a depiction of hard times, always a depiction of struggles. You know that. There's songs written about the valley. In the valley, he restored my soul during the hard times. Those kind of things. That's what he's reflecting on right here. But he's saying, even though I'm in the valley, he said, even though my tears are flowing, he said, the Lord is turning them into a well. He's turning them into a reason for me to hope. He's turning them in for a reason for me to have expectation in him. He's turning them into, a change of my mind and heart to depend more upon him, to truly exercise my faith, to truly get strong in my faith. He's doing that to depend on him. He's turning this time of desperation, this time where I can't do anything myself. David couldn't do a thing about not being able to be at the house of God at that time. He's turning this into pools of water for me. In other words, I'm not out here to dry place. Even if I got to be sustained by my own tears, God sees that and he, listen, the Bible said if we humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God, he'd lift us up. And so that's what he's reflecting on here. He's determined that he is not going to fall and go under because of who he's worshiping and the desire of in the place where he'd like to be, what he'd rather be doing. Notice he said they go from strength to strength. They're weeping, but he's turning these things around for them. They go from strength to strength. Paul wrote it and said it this way to the Corinthians, from glory to glory. They go from strength to strength. Anybody get anything out of this? They go from strength to strength. Every one of them in Zion. Notice that phrase, every one of them in Zion. Should be said this way, every one of them in the house of God. Every one of them of the family of God. Every one of them that makes up the church. Every one of them has this access. Every one of them has this advantage. Every one of them, good preaching, preacher. Every one of them. Notice, he said, he said they go from strength to strength. Every one of them in Zion appeareth before God. What's that mean? You say, oh, here it comes. We've got to appear before the judgment seat of Christ. That's not exactly what he's talking about right there. What he's talking about is, he'd rather be at the house of God. Why? Because God's face and God's focus is upon those people. They appear before God. What's going on with them is not out of his sight. What's going on with them is not away from his hearing. In other words, he said it this way. They've got his attention. When's the last time you thought like that? Whew. I'd love to be at the house of God. I'd love for these struggles to be behind me. I'd love for these conditions to be settled. I'd love for these issues to be over. I'd love for this to be changed. But hey, he sees me. Hey, he's looking straight at me. Hey, I've got his attention. I've got his attention. There's been times, church, I'm telling you, I knew I had his attention. If I didn't have his attention, I wouldn't have made it. If I didn't have his attention, I couldn't have done it. This writer is saying, oh, the house of God. He was determined. Look, if you will, at verse 9, behold, O God, our shield Look at that. Let me get verse 8, about to leave it. O God of hosts, hear my prayer. Give ear. O God of Jacob, Shelah. You notice he said, appear before God. I got your attention. I got his attention. I know he got his attention. I'm going to pray. I'm going to talk to him. Verse 9, on this second point, he said, behold, O God, our shield, and look upon the face of thine anointed. In other words, you're protecting me in this. I can't go. How many can say something like this? It's been a month since I've been to church, and I feel so weak because of it. I've talked to some of our folks that's had some long-term sickness. Oh, listen, either the first, second, not past the third thing they say to me is this: I miss coming to church. I miss the folks at church. I miss being at church. I miss that. In other words, they're telling me this: I really feel a little weaker that I can't come to church. I really feel a little bit more vulnerable that I can't come to church. How many goes out of a good Holy Ghost filled meeting and you feel like you can, listen, you feel like you can take on the world because you've been in the presence of God, or you've received instruction from the scripture and you feel like, hey, I'm ready now. You're still the same person, but the good news is he's that great God that has become greater to you and me because of our more acceptance. We'd rather have him. George Beverly Shea was asked in his day to record some popular music, some secular music, and he was offered a good big sum of money in his day to do all of that. Bev Shea thought about it. He reflected on it. He studied about it, and it was really a temptation to him. Because of his voice tone and the way his style was and everything, these producers really encouraged him and tried to influence him to let him know that he could be, listen, a millionaire. And back in the 40s, $1 million was a lot of money. It's a lot of money now. It was a lot of money. As Bev Shea thought about this, and he prayed about this, and he studied over it, and he meditated on it, the Holy Spirit gave him this song. And the lyric says, I'd rather have Jesus. I'd rather have Jesus. Bev Shea came to this conclusion. The Lord is the one that gave me this talent. The Lord is the one that's opened these doors for me to use it. The Lord deserves all of the recognition from it. And he deserves my service with it. Bev Shea wrote, I'd rather have Jesus than be caught in the world's, it's in our songbook, be caught in the world's great sway. I'd rather have Jesus. Listen, this writer is determined. He's saying he's my shield, and he's looking. He said, he's saying, he look upon the face of thine anointed. I got his attention. And then lastly, he was dedicated. Lastly, he was dedicated. What happens to things that are dedicated? They're designed or set forth for a purpose, aren't they? I mentioned athletes a while ago. When they're dedicated to their game, what do? They hone their skills. They work out their body. They discipline themselves for a purpose, don't they? They do. When things, this pulpit, by the way, is made for a purpose. It's made for this purpose. You'll notice it totally and absolutely meets all the requirements of this purpose. This table is made for this purpose. It's written on the front of it right there. This table is not just any old table. It's a remembrance table. It's a communion table. It's made for this purpose. It's dedicated, if you will, to this purpose. This building is dedicated to this purpose. And when you and I, listen, when we purpose in our heart to walk by faith, we dedicate and discipline our life to the one who died for us, amen, and saved us. In other words, we dedicate. Listen, we dedicated. He was dedicated. We dedicate ourselves. Notice verse 10, and we'll be finished at verse 12. He said, for a day in thy courts, a day where you're being honored, a day where you're making decisions, a day where you have set the agenda, he said, is better than 1,000. And could I add 1,000 anywhere else? That's what he said. It's better than being anywhere else. I had rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God. Let me explain this to you real quickly. We see an illustration of this in Acts chapter 3. The Bible tells us in Acts chapter 3 that the man who was paralyzed from his waist down, was brought at the beautiful gate daily. Remember that? He was brought at the beautiful gate, and he was there to ask some money from the people that would go in and out of the temple, because usually people that were going to church is a little more generous. People of faith was more generous. People that were taking on the identity of God was more generous, because God is tremendously generous. And so they would take him there. That was before any welfare. That was before any sort of aid, and I'm thankful for aid of people that need it. That was before any sort of any kind of these programs existed. And so they'd take him there. They'd get a little money. He'd get a little food. He'd get a little of what he needed. And so they'd take him there, and he'd obviously been successful. But you remember what Peter said to him, "Silver and gold have none, but such as I have, give I unto thee." He takes him by the right hand in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. He said, "Rise up, walk." That's what he done. Well, where he was at is a reflection of what he's just talking about. He said, "I'd rather be a doorkeeper." In other words, I'd rather be at the threshold of the tabernacle. That's where the poor people was took. That's where the people that was in need was took. In other words, he's saying, "I'd rather be in need at the house of God than I had to be out here. I'd rather be the most menial one." Doorkeeper can also mean the one that maintained the place, the one that kept up, picked up after people and these kind of things. The most menial task there. He's saying, "I'd rather have that than I had to have to be away from the house of God. I'd rather have it. I'd rather do it than I had to be away from the house of God." He said, "than to dwell in the tents of wickedness." That word "dwell" there, if you were reading this in the original Hebrew, it would say to be a prince in the tent of wickedness. You'll notice the word "tent." The word "tent" is there for a reason. It's the same. It's like the Greek word interpreted in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and where the Bible talks about if the tent of this tabernacle were dissolved. He's talking about a temporary thing. Temporary. How many knows where we like it or not? We're living in a temporary state. There's many of you that's like me that's lost dear family members you love, and that's really home to us, isn't it? We live in a temporary state. There's no guarantee of tomorrow. No guarantee. But I'm telling you this, for the believer, there's a guaranteed tomorrow. Hallelujah. Yes, there is. Those people that are no longer here with us are there with him that had that testimony when they left. And you'll notice what he said here. He said, "I'd rather be the poorest one, the most insignificant one in the church." You know, a lot of folks won't even come to church unless they can be the most important one. Unless they can, you know, get attention in the church house. Unless they can do things that would bring them attention in the church house. David is saying, "I just soon to go there and not say a word. I just soon to go there and not even be seen. I just soon to go there and be pretty much invisible, just as long as I can go there. Just as long as I can be there. I don't need to draw attention to myself. I don't need to take over the service. I don't need to do anything like that. All I need to be is there. I love it there," he said. He's dedicated. Notice verse 11, "For the Lord God is a sun and shield." The word "sun," you remember what the Lord said to his disciples? "I must work while it is what? Day. Well, I can see how. While the Lord has illuminated my way." That's what he's talking about. He's showing me how to get there. Notice he said, "For the Lord God is a sun and a shield." There's, he's used a second time for that protection, for that provision. He said, "The Lord will give grace." Notice the word "grace," an unusual word for the days of the law. "For the Lord will give grace," or his favor, "and glory." That word "glory" means his authority. "No good thing," he said, "will he withhold from them that walk uprightly." He said, "There's a reason I go to the house of God. There's a reason I'd rather be there. O Lord of hosts, blessed is the man that trusteth in thee." Blessed. In other words, let the evidence speak for itself. As we come with an invitation this morning, boy, tried to be easy on you this morning, Brother Nathan. Didn't ask him to go to a dozen scriptures. He had to support this. This is what the Holy Spirit wanted done. Can I say, listen, in my life and yours, people are looking for the blessing. Did you hear me? They're looking for the blessing. Some of them may try you a little bit, push your buttons. Just see how you react. What they're looking for is not the same thing they got. They're looking for the blessing. They're looking for that Jesus in you and me. They're looking for that Christ-likeness in us. That's what they're looking for. That's what they're, listen, searching for. They're looking for the blessing. Oh, friend, David said, and I do believe David wrote this, I do believe he wrote it when he was having to stay away from Jerusalem because of his son. Can you imagine what a shape he was in? I can't turn around and kill my son. I can't turn around and bring my army and bring my valiant men, my men of valor to bear on my son. I'll just leave. Hopefully we can work it out. You remember what he told him? He said, don't do him any harm. Don't kill him. The scripture said he cried. Absalom was a tremendously handsome man. He was a tremendously well thought of man. He was a celebrity in Israel. He cut his hair once in a year. People would show up just to see how much it weighed, what he cut off. Well, that'd be great, wouldn't it? Be great to have hair that thick. That same luxurious hair is what got him killed. He got it caught in an oak, pulled him off his mule. The king's sons of princes would ride mules, not necessarily horses. They were highly valued and prized. Got his hair caught. Imagine his hair being that thick. It caught him in the limbs, held him there. He couldn't get away until Joab came and killed him. But the king said, don't touch him, don't hurt him. My point is, David was between a real rock and a hard place. But what he longed for the most, he didn't write a psalm that said, I long to sit on my throne. He didn't write a psalm that said, I long to be back in the palace. He didn't write a psalm that said, I long to be in the chariot. He didn't write a psalm that said, I long to go over to the armory and to look at my shields and my weaponry. He wrote a psalm that said, I love to go back to the house of God. I love to go back to the people of God. I love to go back to the atmosphere charged with the things of God. I'd love to go back to that place. I'd rather be there than anywhere else. I'd love to go back there. I wish all this was done and over, but I'd love to be there. That's where I want to be. What had you rather do today? What's the most important thing to us this morning? How is the world around us perceiving us? Are they seeing what we'd rather do? Maybe talking to somebody watching us this morning if we're still live streaming. Like I said before, the folks who are here are here. If they'd rather have stayed in bed, they could have. If they'd rather have went to the mall, they could have. If they'd rather have been doing something else, they could have. But yet they are here. The evidence speaks for itself. They are here. You're there at home for a reason. And you may have rather be here, like I said before. Maybe there for a good reason. May not be able to go anymore, but you'd rather be able to be in a place like this one. Hey, what do we rather do? When we face conflict, what did we rather do? When we deal with adverse things, what did we rather do? David said, I'd rather be at the house of God. I'd rather be around the people of the Lord. I'd rather be in a place that honored Him. Quite frankly, can I say this today? A place that honors God should honor you. Do you know that? Should honor you too. You should feel honored too. I hope you do. Let's pray for folks because we'd rather see their lives changed. Let's pray for folks because we'd rather see their needs met. We'd rather see them not struggle. Can I encourage you today to let the Lord use you? You might say, now what are you talking about? Listen, operate in the way that the Scriptures instructs us to. Operate in the way that we'd rather people treat us. Let's treat them that way. Let's operate that way. Let's start that way. Let it start at home. Amen. If I'm no help to Cindy at home, I sure can't be any help to you here. Let's start at home. What would you rather do? I can say this today. The Lord had rather bless you. He had rather bless you than have chastisement come in our life. He had rather provide for you than have you do without. He had rather listen. He had rather encourage you to see you than to see you walking around in discouragement and defeat. He'd rather these things happen. That's why he sent this word. He'd rather, amen, he'd rather see the good things of God working in a real way in your life and mine. He'd rather do that. And when we line our mind up, listen, we're saved. Those of us are truly saved. Can I say to you today, listen, we're truly saved. The old nature has been done away with, but listen, then we've got to train our mind on the things that gets us in line with what God had rather do. Does that make sense? Are we doing that today? So let's stand. Thank you for listening so intently this morning. What's your heart toward the things of God today? Rather be here than I had to be in jail this morning. I'd rather be here than I had to be in the hospital. I'd rather be here than I had to be at the funeral home. I'd rather be here than I had to be at the lawyer's office. I'd rather be here than I had to be in the courtroom. Think of a lot of places I'd rather be here than there. But you know something? I'd rather be here than I had just sitting at the home doing nothing. I had nothing happening but the TV on. Had some folks ask me one time. Well, I've had them ask me more than once. What do you think about fishing on Sunday? What do you think about hunting on Sunday? What do you think about these kind of things? What do you think about playing a ball game on Sunday? What do you think about those things? You know what I've told them? I've told them, hey, if you can stop that, if your church that you attend has an evening service, you've been to the morning service, you're doing those activities after service. And if your church has an evening service and you have a conscience to attend your church, if the fish are biting, you can stop fishing and go back to church. If the ball game's not over yet, but you can bail out and go back to church. If the deer are walking right underneath your stand, but it's church time and you got to go get ready and get back to church, if you can do that, hallelujah. I'd rather have you doing that than I had sitting at home watching TV. TV ain't that good a thing. Unless you find something decent to watch. But I told them I'd rather them do that. Why? Because it was a better influence on them than some of these things we can find to watch on TV. I'm glad that you had rather come to church this morning. Thank you for being here. Really appreciate it so much. If you can, come back and study the scriptures tonight. Be good to have the doors back open, the lights back on. We're not starting the evening services up right at the moment. We're going to kind of work you back into that, but we'll see how our study goes tonight. I trust it'll be blessed. Like I said, I'm looking forward to it. I'd rather be here than I had at home watching the Munsters. I found the Munsters on Sunday. I'd rather do that. I've seen them all. I've always said, I'm
Sunday night service will be the 2nd, 4th, and like tonight, the 5th Sunday night.
That's right. Yeah.